Everyone, on this video, we will explain the material about the Usher model. I'm Angel, and I will explain you about what the Usher model is. Usher is an acronym that stands for the various steps in the model, which consists of six important components. A stands for analyze learners, S stands for state objectives, the second S stands for select methods, media, and materials. U stands for utilize media and material. R stands for require learner participants. E stands for evaluate and revise. This model is a procedural guide for planning and conducting instruction that incorporates media and technology. It is designed to help teachers effectively plan and implement lessons utilizing technology and media. It also refers to a systematic approach of writing lesson plans that helps teachers in organizing instructional procedures. The Usher model focuses on planning surrounding the actual classroom's use of media and technology. It is a way to ensure that the learning environment is appropriate for students.
Hello everyone, Uki is speaking here, and I will explain to you the A part of the Usher. The first step in the Usher model is to analyze learners. It refers to identifying your students or your audience. Why educators should identify the learners? Because there must be a match between the characteristic of learners and the contents of methods, media, and materials. So, by analyzing learners, educators can create the good methods and media adjusting the learners' characteristics. There are several factors to be identified. The first one is general characteristic. It is including age, grade level, job or position, and culture or socioeconomic factors. Perhaps your students are new to you and you haven't understood them yet. So, here is the part when instructors or educators observing their students to adjust the learning media or methods. The second one is specify entry competencies. It refers to knowledge and skills that learners either possess or lack. When you begin to plan any lessons, your first assumption are that learners are lack the knowledge or skills you are going to teach and that they possess the knowledge or skills they need to understand and learn from the lesson. The last one is learning style. It refers to a cluster of psychological traits that determine how an individual perceives, interacts with, and responds emotionally to a learning environment. Every learner has different style of learning. For example, some students prefer use audio medium, and the other prefer use visual medium. Some students prefer work in group, and the others prefer work individually. Those different styles are affected by several factors, such as perceptual preferences and strengths, information processing habits, motivational factors, and psychological factors. So, as an educator, you should understand this all to create the best methods and media to learn.
Hello, I'm Dina, and I'm going to explain about state objectives. What is objective? It is about what will be achieved and how it will be achieved in terms of learning process. And an objective should be as specific as possible. So, why should teachers state instructional objectives? Because it makes appropriate selection of method and media. It creates a learning environment in which the objectives can be reached. And then it helps ensure proper evaluation. Well, here are the ABCDs of well-stated objectives. What are the requirements of a well-stated objective? The first one is audience. It focuses on what learners are doing, not the teacher. It means accomplishment of the objective depends on what learners do. The objective begins by stating whose capability is going to be changed. The second one is behavior. It reflects the real-world capability learners need. The third one is condition. A statement of objectives should include the conditions under which the performance is observed. And the last one is degree. It indicates the standard or criterion by which acceptable performance will be judged, either qualitative or quantitative. And then, the classification of objectives. The first one is cognitive skills. It emphasizes the capability of absorbing knowledge in form of verbal or visual, memorization or recall of facts. The second one is affective skills. It involves feeling and values. The third one is motor skills. It involves athletic, manual, and physical skills. And the last one is interpersonal skills. It involves interaction among people, for example, teamwork. And we are coming to the relation between objectives and individual differences. Objectives are not intended to limit what students learn, but provide minimum level of expected achievement. Serendipitous or incidental learning means students progress toward an objective. And then, incidental learning takes different forms with different students.
Hi, I'm Handy. Me and my friend will discuss about selecting methods, media, and materials. The first one is steps. The selection process has three steps. Step 1. Deciding on the appropriate method for the given learning tasks. Step 2. Choosing a media format that is suitable for carrying the method. Step 3. Selecting, modifying, or designing specific materials within that media format. And then we will move to choosing method. There are a few things you need to know about choosing methods. The first is, there is no method that is the best or that can cope with all needs in learning equally well. The second is, teachers often combine two or more methods to achieve their objectives in learning. And next is choosing a media format. A media format is the physical form in which a message is incorporated and displayed. Each media format has different strengths and limitations in terms of the types of message that can be recorded and displayed. And these are several types of media formats. And next is things to consider in media selection models. The first one is instructional situation. Is it large group, small group, or self-instruction? And the second is learner variables. The third is the nature of the objective. Is it cognitive, affective, motor skill, or interpersonal? The three points above must be considered to the presentational capabilities of each of the media formats. And the fourth is, some models also take into consideration the capability of each format to give feedback to the learner. And we will move to obtaining specific materials. Obtaining appropriate materials will generally involve one of three alternatives. If the materials are already available and can allow your students to meet your objectives, Then you can just choose the available material. You can save both time and money, right? But if the available materials do not match with your objective or not suitable for your audience, the alternative is modifying the materials. And if this doesn't work, the final alternative is designing your own materials that allows you to meet your objectives.
My name is Laurencia Nidiasari and I'm number 050. First, I'm going to talk about selecting available materials. The majority of instructional materials used by teachers and trainers are off the shelf. That is, ready-made and available from school, district or company collections or other easily accessible sources. The decision about whether to use a particular piece of instructional material depends on several factors. Based on McAlpin and Watson, recent research confirms that certain criteria are critical in the appraisal of materials. Before selecting a media, a teacher has to consider these basic rules or points. The first one is media should be selected on the basis of student need. Second, we must consider the total learning situation. Third, should follow learning objectives. Fourth, must be appropriate for teaching format. Fifth, should be consistent with the student's capabilities and learning styles. Sixth, should be chosen objectively. Seventh, should be selected in order to best meet the learning outcomes. And last but not least, no single medium is the total solution. Then we move to modifying existing materials. If you cannot locate any suitable materials, you can always modify what is available, and this can be both challenging and creative. The example of modification technique, which many instructors overlook, is to show just a portion of a video, stop the VCR, discuss what has been presented, then continue with another short segment followed by additional discussion. Modification also can be made in the audio portion of foreign language materials or English language materials used in a bilingual classroom. Narration can be changed from one language to another or from a more advanced rendition of a foreign language to a simpler one. And then, the last topic is designing new materials. Certain basic considerations must be taken into account when designing new materials. For example, the first one is cost. Is sufficient money available in your budget to meet the cost? Second, equipment. Do you have the necessary equipment to produce or use the materials you intend to design? Then, technical expertise. Do you have the necessary expertise to design and produce the kind of materials you wish to use? And then, facilities. If your design calls for use of special facilities for preparation, or use of your materials, are such facilities available? And then last but not least, is time. Can you afford to spend whatever time necessary to design and produce the kind of materials you have in mind?
The next part of Azure model is utilize media and material. I'm Angel and I will explain about some points of this part. This step in the Azure process concerns making a plan as to how you will utilize the media and materials that you have selected. This step is very important to make sure that everything works appropriately, and it is also the step where you develop your plan for implementing your media and materials. The first point of this step is previewing the material. It is very important to preview the media and materials before the lesson to make sure that the whole lesson will go smoothly and seamlessly. During this process, You should determine that the materials are appropriate for your audience and objectives. After previewing, the next step that you should do is preparing for the material. You need to prepare the media and materials to support the instructional activities that you plan to use. Firstly, you need to gather all the material and equipment that you will need to teach your lesson. And after that, you should determine in what sequence you will use the materials and media. And the last is, you should anticipate what materials the students will need and be prepared to secure any necessary additional materials.
Amanisa, I will continue the next step of utilize media and material in Azure model. Prepare the environment. Wherever the learning is to take place, such as in the classroom, in a laboratory, at the media center, and on the athletic field, the facilities will have to be arranged for proper student use of the materials and media. So, you should check that equipment is in working order, whether it is to be used by you or by your student. Then, arrange all of the facilities so that the learning process can run properly. For example, because the primary portion of the lesson is small group work, the teacher arranges the student desk in the classroom to form table areas. This will prepare the students for the group work when they come to the class, so the lesson will not need to be interrupted. I have another example, is when we are in listening class, the teacher should be prepared and should check all of the equipments which are used in this class, whether it can be used by us properly or not. Then, prepare the learners. What is learned in from an activity depends highly on how learners are prepared for the lesson. So, in this step, you get several functions, such as increasing motivation, providing a rationale apply whether the lesson is teacher-based or student-centered. For example, to prepare the students, teacher presents the overall plans and objectives for the lesson. Each student receives a handout describing the small group activity. So, it's same with us. When we have a new meeting in some class, the lecturer will give us a handout that describes the plans of our activity in those class. Then, the purpose of this activity is helping learners create a mental map of what they need to absorb. Next, provide the learning experience. If the material are teacher-based, you should present like a professional. One term for this is showmanship or classroom presentation skill. So, the instructor should be able to direct attention in the classroom. Then, when if the experience is student-centered, you have to play the role of guide and facilitator. It means that the teacher are capable to help their students to explore the topic by some ways. For example, during the introduction phases of the lesson, the teacher presents material using overhead projector, a data projector, computer, flip chart, and VCR. So, when the teacher uses computer and overhead projector as a media, this activity helps them to deliver the material easily.
Now, I will talk about required learner participation. The participation that we want to discuss is feedback. Feedback is so important. All perspectives emphasize the importance of feedback. In behaviorists, feedback is important because knowledge of correct response serves as a reinforcer of appropriate behaviors. In cognitivists, feedback is important because information about results helps to enrich learners' mental schemata. In constructivism, feedback is important because meaning and knowledge is in change with each personal experience. In social psychologists, feedback is important because interpersonal feedback provides both corrective information and emotional support. Feedback can come from many ways. First, it can come from oneself. For example, experiencing the feel when we learn something new, like excited, happy, or maybe sad. Then we have print sources. For example, turning to the back of the book to find the correct answers to a practice exercise. Then we have from a device. When we accidentally misspelling write a word in Microsoft Word, Microsoft Word will underline the word. And then we have from other people. It's like your friend agree with your opinion or give you an advice to your problem. Then we have interpersonal feedback. Research indicates that the most powerful feedback is interpersonal feedback because face-to-face reactions are more vivid than printed or graphic information. To develop the feedback, we can do some activities. For example, new spelling or vocabulary words, solving mathematic problems on worksheet, rehearsing a basketball play, creating an original product. There are two kinds of response. First, observable. It's like manipulation of task card illustrating the stages of mitosis. And then the second, unobservable. It's like silent repetition of phrases heard on an English language tape.
Hello, my name is Angelica Prasanti and I will talk about evaluate and revise. There are two purposes of evaluation, assessing learner achievement and evaluating methods and media. Evaluation are made before, during, and after the instruction. For examples, before instruction, measure the learner characteristic to make sure that student skills match with the methods and the material are used. During instructions, may take the form of student practice with feedback. It is designed to find and correct the problems and difficulties that may affect student achievement. Assessment of learning achievement. The objective will help to develop the criteria for evaluating the student's performance. The method of assessing achievement depends on the nature of the objective. There are two types of objective skills. The first one, simple cognitive skills, such as recalling, distinguishing, and summarizing. The second one is process-type behaviors, such as conducting, performing, solving, creating products such as structure and composition, and an exhibit of attitudes such as tolerating, appreciating, and contributing. Rising assessment is driven by commitment to competency-based instruction and constructivist pedagogy. Assessment is often used to measure student learning, to inform student and their parents or guardian of student progress, and to give grades. Authentic assessment. Authentic assessment is assessment of skills required in the real world. It requires students to demonstrate what they have learned. The characteristics of authentic assessment are: have more than one correct approach, are thought-provoking, not simply requiring recall memorized facts, require decision-making rather than just rote memorization, develop thinking in a variety of ways, lead to other problems to be solved, and raise other questions. Types of authentic assessments are students' projects, such as writing assignment, science projects, and posters. Performance, such as giving speech, demonstrating gymnastics, and self-defense. Oral questioning by both teachers and other students. Discussions of controversial topics and current events.
portfolios, including examples of student work with summarizes and reflections. Then how to assess students' process skills. A performance checklist can be effective for attitudes, long-term observation or attitude skill. For product skills, a product rating checklist can guide the evaluation. Next, evaluation of methods and media. Evaluation also includes assessment of instructional methods and media. It is about the effectiveness of the instructional materials in arousing students' interest, assisting the students to meet the objectives, and providing meaningful students' participation. The improvement of those materials, time management, the future use, and the modification. Class discussion, individual interviews, and observation of student behavior should be used to evaluate instructional media and methods. Conversation with the school media specialist about the value of specific media will help to alert the need improving the lessons in the future. Evaluation of instructor. The instructor, as an important component of instructional system, should be evaluated to improve. There are four basic types of instructor evaluation: self, student, peer, and administrator. I'll explain as if you guys are the teachers or instructors. For self-evaluation, record your presentation, then view it while using an evaluation form. Student can also provide valuable feedback. For the peer, ask another teacher to observe your teaching skills and ask for an evaluation, including what teaching aspect you want to improve. The last one is administrator. School administrator visit teachers on a scheduled sequence. They have a standard form to observe teachers and provide feedback. The last one is revision. The final step, look at the result of your evaluation data. Reflect on the lesson and each component of it. Make notes immediately, refer to them before you implement the lessons again. If your evaluation data indicates shortcomings, go back to the faulty parts of the plan and revise it. The model works, but only if you constantly use it to upgrade the quality of the instructions. Thank you.